Good afternoon. Once again, we greet you from this ministry, Revelation 14:1, located here in Santa Rosa, California. Our main goal is to share the truth of the Bible. And we hope and pray that that's exactly what we've been doing in our past teachings. The videos are all located on YouTube and in Facebook. And we pray that wherever you are, wherever you're watching this small nuggets of truth, that will help you expand on the truth of the Bible, that the world today is being clouded with false teachings. So today, our topic for today is the safeguard for the Christians. Safeguard for Christians. What can we guard ourselves against all that is surrounding us in these last days? If we just quickly review what we learned last week, we learned the claims of false Christs. The Bible talks about false Christs coming in these last days. People who will claim to be Christ. And we hear it now and then over the news, but this will keep on increasing as we move towards the end. Unholy angels performing miracles. This is another thing that is happening right here today. We see miracles, and that is a sort of a test of the Holy Spirit. If there's no miracles, then there's no Holy Spirit. But we know very well from what we found out in the Bible that the devil himself is also performing miracles. So the test of being performing miracles is not a true test for what is the truth. Thirdly, persecution of those who uphold the truth. We found that out last week, that when you stand up for the truth, two big institutions come against you: the church, Christianity itself, and the state, government. And there's also a third institute, which is the religious body. Not only Christianity, but other religions. So persecution, for those who want to uphold the truth, persecution, you should expect persecution. And finally, number four, Satan himself will personate Christ. That will be the ultimate of Satan's impersonation. He will himself personate Christ and claim that he himself changed the Sabbath from the seventh day of the week to the first day of the week. So Satan himself, right? And then he'll come and claim, put to rest the doubt that people, the truth, those who are standing up for the truth are saying that there's nowhere in the Bible you can find the changing of the day of worship. But then Satan himself will come and say, I myself, and we know how to test that out. Satan will only be seen in parts of the world. You will watch it on TV. Jesus said, when I come back, who will see me? The whole world will see me. So if you're only watching Satan, watching Jesus on TV, that's not a true test. So our only true test is the Word of God. Let's move on. How do we defend against all these odds? How do we defend ourselves? We will be overwhelmed by all these false teachings that are around us. We see that the battle between Satan and Jesus, Satan and God, has gone on now for over 6,000 years, right from the beginning, when Adam and Eve sinned, or even before that, when Satan himself rebelled against God. That's when this conflict started. It has been running on for 6,000 years, through the ages, through the prophets, through the Israelites, through Jesus' time. And 2,000 years after Jesus, here we are. That conflict, this controversy, is getting even more intense. But very soon, it will come to an end. This great conflict between truth and falsity, between evil and good, will very soon come to an end. Two, the wicked one redoubles his effort to defeat the work of Christ. That is Satan himself and his holy, unholy angels, to keep men entrapped in his snares or in his false teachings. Satan is hard at work. He wants to keep us under his bind, to keep us together under his false teachings, so that no one will be able to focus on Christ himself. Holding the people in darkness is his goal, while Christ's mediation is going on. When we study about the sanctuary, we see that Jesus Christ is now in the judgment. Judgment is taking place right now. And you see, during the judgment, what is Christ doing? He is mediating between you and me. Mediating between us and God. When you confess your sins to him, he will fight your case in that judgment, in that court. He'll be telling his father, I have already died for this man. He's confessing his sins. He realizes that he cannot cleanse himself, but my blood has already been spilled for him. So it is during this time that Satan wants us to be suppressed, to stay in the darkness. He is working hard right now because judgment is still going on in heaven. When there's judgment going on in heaven, there's still a chance for human beings, sinful human beings, to be directed back to God, because Jesus is still fighting for you there. He's still mediating for you. Satan is hard at work because Christ is working up there in that court of judgment. At the end of Christ's mediation for men, there will be no longer be any sacrifice, and any one who is deceived will be lost forever. That is what Satan is waiting for. The end of that mediation, the end of Christ's work in the judgment. He's waiting for that. While he is in the judgment, while he is mediating, Christ wants to suppress us. Satan wants to suppress us. He wants to keep us in darkness. He wants to teach us false teachings, so that we may not be able to see through his trickery and see Christ right through. So that's Christ's, Satan's dilemma. He wants to keep us under in the darkness while Christ is mediating for us. Excuse me. Attention to the truth. When man's attention is directed to the truth, the mind begins to question. Mind begins to inquire. Is this the truth that I've been hearing all this time? Or is there another set of truths? So Satan does not want man to be in that state, the state where he is asking questions. Is this the truth? Is this biblical? They question, what must I do to be saved? You see, when man becomes, starts to question, this is what they will end up with. Am I saved? Or what shall I do so that I may be saved, so that I may attain eternal life? Satan does not want us to be in that condition, to be asking questions, to be inquiring about the truth. Satan does not like this and will be there in the ground seeking to match his power against Christ's. Satan is hard at work, guys. He will be there to confuse us. He is there all the time to keep us under wrap, keep us in darkness. He does not want us to see Christ. He continues to counteract the influence of the Holy Spirit, even to the point of death. The Holy Spirit wants to give us life. Satan would want to counteract that power, even if it will cost you your life. He will kill you so that you do not see through his darkness. And remember the Sunday Global Decree we talked about last week? It will be accompanied by a death penalty that anyone can carry out. That's how desperate Satan is. The law will be put out by the state. All over the world, we've seen that all these entities will come together. Christianity, the state, religion. And that means the whole world, all over the world. And it'll come together with a decree that anyone who is still standing up for the truth will have to die. It comes with that decree. And who is given the power to kill? Anyone. You can imagine how confused this world will be because of that decree. Study the scriptures. We are talking about our defense against all this. Our defense. Only those who have been diligent students of the scriptures and who have received the love of the truth will be shielded from the powerful delusions that takes the world captive. By the Bible testimony, these will detect the deceiver in his disguise. Only those who diligently study the Bible. These are the people who will be able to see the truth. Only those who diligently study the Bible. We can just read the Bible like a majority of Christians do. The Spirit of Prophecy says, only those who have been. That means it's not just something you do today and that's it. You continue to do all along. Only those who have been diligently studying the scriptures, this will and have received the love of the truth, these are the ones who will be shielded. These are the ones who have that safeguard from the powerful delusion, from the confusion, from the errors that Satan has dumped into this, into Christianity today. By the Bible testimonies, this will detect the deceivers in this disguise. The deceivers will come up with something. The man of God will use his safeguard. Only this. Because of this, he will be able to detect the deceiver in his disguise. Only through the word of God, the Bible itself. Be aware, guys. Revelation chapter 12, verse 17. Let's read together. 2, 3. The dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Both the testimony of Jesus Christ and the commandments of God are found right here in this book. The dragon is wroth with the woman. The dragon, who is the dragon? Satan himself. He is angry. He doesn't like that woman, that clean woman. And he goes and make war with the woman. The woman is the church, and the church is you and me. Those of us who decide to keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. This will be the people who will be under attack during these last days. The dragon is angry with you. The dragon is angry with the church. Angry, the devil is angry with the woman. And he will come out and make war with you. So, all this teaching of peace, all this teaching of financial success, and richness is all a lie. Because if you stand up for the truth, that dragon is coming after you. Our only safeguard. With so many voices in the world today, where can we turn to find the truth? We go to church, we hear something. Turn on the television, we hear something. We put on the radio as we travel in our cars, we hear something. All this confuses us. Where can we get the truth? How can we know God's will and guard against Satan's deception? See, these are the questions that a mind that has been liberated will start to ask. They need answers because they want to attain eternal life. And when they begin to do that, Satan is hard at work. Does it really matter what we believe? Some people say, oh, you just love your neighbor. What you believe doesn't really matter. Is it true? God's word. This is our test. We've heard this verse over and over again, and we should not tire of hearing it again. Isaiah chapter 8, verse 20. To the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. To the law and to the testimony. They speak not according to this word. It is because there is no light in them. So, the truth is only found in this word. No matter what you hear, no matter how highly qualified the person who is preaching, if what he's teaching does not go together with his word, Christ says there is no light in them. The people of God should be directed to the scriptures as the safeguard against the influence of false teachers and the delusive power of the spirit of darkness. So always direct the people back to the Bible. Always do that. We can tell our story, our own story, our testimony, but direct them to where they will find whose testimony? Testimony of Jesus Christ. Direct them towards where they will find the commandment. The whole world of the Bible talks about the commandment, both in the Old and the New Testament. Direct them there. That's where they will find the truth. The Bible's plain utterances reveal Satan's deception. When they begin to dig into the Bible, Satan's falsity is exposed. They will know exactly. When they hear something, they know that this is the deception. This is wrong. It's a false teaching. Because they know what the Word of God talks about. So closely will the counterfeit resemble the true that it will be impossible to distinguish between them except by the Holy Spirit. The truth and the false, they are very close to each other. Without this Bible, you won't know which one is the truth and which one is the error. Only the Holy Scripture will help us distinguish which one is the truth. So it's very important that as you guide people back to Christ, use the Word of God. The right conception of his character. Those who endeavor to obey all the commandments of God will be opposed and derided. Darkness before dawn, page 36. Those who endeavor to obey all the commandments will be derided. So expect persecution. Expect people to come against you because you are upholding the commandments of God. They can stand only in God in order to endure. Oh, they can stand only in God in order to endure the trial before them. They must understand the will of God as revealed in his word. So you don't expect to go and live a luxurious life, because the Bible does not talk about that. In this last day, they say you will be persecuted, you will die. So don't expect to go and live a peaceful life if you want to stand for the truth. They can honor him only as they have a right conception of his character. When you know God deeply, have a proper relationship with him, you will know what to expect. The conception of his character, government, and purposes, and act in accordance with them. That's the person of God. He knows the God that he serves. He knows Jesus Christ personally. He lives by the commandments of God. And he knows the testimony of Jesus Christ. Because he knows him well, he expects. He knows what to expect. And he's not expecting a luxurious life. No. He's expecting attack from the devil. Satan is not happy with him. The dragon is wroth with that woman. That's the right conception of the character of Christ. Look at Christ himself, his life on this earth. He did not even have a house to live in. He slept on the roadside with his disciples. That's the kind of life. When you follow your master, don't expect to live a luxurious life. God or man? In Darkness Before Dawn, page 36, paragraph 2. Spirit of Prophecy says, none but those who have fortified the mind with the truths of the Bible will stand through the last great conflict. So who will stand through this last day's conflict? Only those who have fortified their mind with the truth of the Bible. Only those people. To every soul will come the searching test. Shall I obey God rather than men? When the Sunday law is enforced, your life will be at stake. This is the question that you will ask yourself. Should I obey God or should I obey the government? Am I afraid of God or am I afraid of men with guns? The decisive hour is even now at hand. That hour of that decision making is getting closer and closer to us. Things are happening fast in the law-making, in the congresses of the governments of today, in the parliaments. This thing is being pushed up through these systems, so that when it is ready, the one world government will take over. So everywhere around the world, in whatever shape or form, these systems are being pushed through the state, through the government, to be discussed and to put into law. So the Spirit of Prophecy is warning us, it is very close. It is right there. It is now at hand. Very close. So the people of God, those who want to stand up for the truth, prepare yourself. Now, are your feet planted on the rock of God's immutable word? Are we prepared to stand firm in defense of the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus? Well, that's the question that we have. Is our faith strong enough that we will decide against men and choose God during that time? If not, then now, there's still time, guys, to improve on our faith. The basis of all doctrines. Darkness Before Dawn, page 37, paragraph 2. But God will have a people upon the earth to maintain the Bible. And the Bible only, as the standard of all doctrines and the basis of all reforms. Unlike what Elijah thought during his time, he said, I'm the only one here. And what did God tell him? I have 7,000 other men, men who are true to me. So, if you don't do it, there are other people who will stand up for God's truth. God have faithful people who are still out there. God is trying to call out through our message. God, who's trying to call out through other people who are influencing the mind of God's people to come out of the traps they are in. Come out of her, my people. So Christ knows that he has a lot of people who are still there, trapped in the churches who are teaching false doctrines. If you, who claim to know the truth, do not stand up today, these are the people who God will use. So never be complacent. The opinions of learned men, the deduction of science, the creeds of decision of ecclesiastical councils, as numerous and discordant as are the churches which they represent, the voice of the majority, not one nor all of these should be regarded as evidence for or against any point of religious faith. These are what Christianity rely on today. They rely on highly learned men. They rely on people with PhDs. Nearly all our pastors have PhDs. They all go to be trained. But the Spirit of Prophecy says, do not rely on learned men. Because these men, their minds have been twisted by the devil himself. Most of our religious schools have been penetrated by false teachers. The Jesuits have infiltrated most of our schools. And we cannot rely on learned men. No, not on learned men. The deduction of science. They bring science using their highly educated minds to come and convince us that evolution is the truth. This is our basis of the truth, not science, as preached by men. Creeds or decisions of ecclesiastical councils. We learn of the Council of Nicaea in the 600 AD. We learn of Vatican II, where things were discussed by these highly positioned people of the churches. And we are teaching it in our churches today. I hear it in churches where I go to. The Nicaea Creed. This is what the Spirit of Prophecy is talking about. The creeds or decisions of ecclesiastical councils. What they decide up there becomes the basis of what the churches will have to do. If you read Vatican II, the Council, Vatican II, you'll see where the basis of the celebration movement comes in. It was discussed in Vatican II in the 1960s. Ecclesiastical councils becomes the basis or foundation of churches of today. Churches of today. Notice. This has been thrown aside. What these people discuss in ecclesiastical councils become the basis of what the churches preach today. Before accepting any doctrine or precept, we should demand the plain, thus saith the Lord, in its support. Any new teaching that comes in, we should ask those people who bring it in, where in the Bible? Today, the LGBT teachings have just gone through into the churches. Most of our churches. No one is asking. No one is standing up to ask. Where in the Bible? Where is the thus saith the Lord? Is it supported by this? No. It's been discussed by ecclesiastical councils. They say, yeah, let them come in and let them preach. You can conduct a wedding ceremony between two people of the same sex right there in the church. Ecclesiastical councils. What they decide have become the basis of the churches of today. Look to bishops, pastors, etc. Satan is constantly endeavoring to attract attention to the man in the place of God. He leads the people to look to bishops, to pastors, to professors of theology as their guides. We are looking up to these people, highly learned people, people of the council, and we think that they are our example. Not according to the book. There's only one example, and that is Jesus Christ. Instead of searching the scriptures to learn their duty for themselves, we look at these highly educated people and they think that whatever they say is the right thing. We hear, where have you been educated? This guy has been to university and he's a pastor and he's all this. Spirit of prophecy warns us against these people. Then, by controlling the minds of these leaders, he can influence the multitude according to his will. All Satan has to do is to control the mind of these leaders, professors, pastors, bishops. Once he controls them, these people control the people. The whole whole group will just follow after them. Instead, they should be following Christ. That's in Darkness Before Dawn, page 38, paragraph 1. The language of false teachers. The truth most plainly revealed in the Bible have been involved in doubt and darkness by learned men, who with the pretense of great wisdom, they pretend to be wise, teach that the scripture, this is the trick, they teach that the scripture have a mystical, a secret, spiritual meaning, not apparent in the language employed. That's why at one time the word of God was only preached in the Latin language, in the Catholic church. These men are false teachers. It was to such a class that Jesus declared, "You know not the scriptures, neither the power of God." That's something that we should be concerned about. Those people that we look highly up to, Spirit of Prophecy says, these men are false teachers. It was to such a class that Jesus declared, "You know not the scriptures, neither the power of God." That's found in Mark chapter 12, verse 24. So, learn the book. Learn the scripture on your own. Go to churches. Listen to what they preach. But it's your duty. If you want to attain eternal life, if you want to stand up for the truth, you have to know it. And you won't learn it from the learned men. You learn it on your own, studying the Bible. This is where the truth is. Darkness Before Dawn, page 38, chapter 4. Plain Bible language. The language of the Bible should be explained according to its obvious meaning. It's very simple. unless a symbol or figure is employed. We talk about the book of Revelation, there's so many figures and symbols used there. That's what it means. Otherwise, just take the plain meaning that it's written in. Christ has given the promise, if any man will do his will, he shall know the doctrine. So to know the doctrine, what should you do? Just do Christ's will. So to do his will, first you have to know him. Study Christ. Study Christ. Know who he is. Know his purpose of coming to this earth. And you'll know his will. And he says, if you know my will, you shall know of the doctrines, the true doctrines. John chapter 7, verse 17. That's what Jesus said. Jesus himself said. If man would but take the Bible as it reads, if there were no false teachers to mislead and confuse their minds, a work would be accomplished that would make angels glad, and that would bring into the fold of Christ thousands upon thousands who are now wandering in error. If we can just simply read the Bible and interpret it as it, as the words, that's what the spirit of prophecy is saying. Keep it simple. Don't be like the wise, the learned, who make things complicated by using flamboyant languages to confuse the congregation. That's why we look highly at them. We think that they are speaking a different language that we cannot understand. These are godly people. These are the men of God. That's the terms that we use. But spirit of prophecy says they are false teachers. They should just use simple words to explain the Bible. So what are we up against to conclude today's session? First of all, time. Time is short. Time is very short. Second, because of the shortness of time, Satan is hard at work to keep us underbound, to keep us in the dark, so that we may not be able to see Christ. Three, we are also up against persecution and death. If we want to stand for the truth, we will face this. So this is something that we will have to have the strength, the power from God to be able to go through persecution and death. And number four, false teachings. People have been flooded with false teachings. And to undo that false teachings, you have to learn how to spread the word. You have to, first of all, learn the Bible, because there will be lots of questions and you need to answer those questions. Learn the Bible. Because the false teachings have really clouded man's mind today, that it's very difficult for them to see through the light of the plain language of the Bible. The work is not easy. We will need Christ's help and guidance. Praying and fasting, as we learned in Sabbath school today, are the tools that we can use to enable us to penetrate this world of darkness because of the false teachings that has clouded Christianity of today. So that's the end of our session today, and I hope that whatever we've learned from the spirit of prophecy will help us make our own decision to study the Bible on our own and ask the Holy Spirit to come and interpret it for us. We cannot rely on learned men. We cannot rely on our pastors. We cannot rely on our bishops. We just have to rely on ourselves and the Holy Spirit to interpret things for us. Let us pray.